What is up, everybody? This is topkek, host of Dang News. Well, lately, I've been kind of bored. The videos that I recently uploaded, those two videos to the channel, were actually filmed a while ago, and therefore I had them kicking around on this machine, not this machine, but the old video editing machine's hardware. I will be showing this setup another time. I've definitely improved the video editing or video capture studio setup by a lot, but that'll be for another video. The whole point of this video is, well, I don't think I had an idea of doing this, and I completely bailed on it. But the idea was to take a Power PC Macintosh machine and throw Linux on it, a Power PC version of Linux. Now, for those who are interested in hearing a little rant on this, Linux developers will throw applications at anything. I mean, like, there's Power PC versions for those modded Xbox that I thought about doing, but I haven't done. I probably will do it in the future. But for those who do not know, that Xbox is a Power PC machine. So you, in theory, could install Lubuntu or Kubuntu. Lu as in Lubuntu and Kubuntu. I'm actually going to be trying Kubuntu. I haven't tried Kubuntu before. At least not at all. I've only really been familiar with Kali Linux and Ubuntu and Puppy Linux for the most part. And maybe a little bit of, I forgot the name of it, but that's not the point. I figured I got a couple of PowerPC Macs kicking around in there. I've got a Power Mac G5 that's upstairs that I really don't want to take out of the closet, so I'm probably not going to use, but I don't want to do the Power Mac G4 because I got a bunch of vintage games on that, so I might just use the Emac over here, because Emac is actually better than the Power Mac G4, and the reason why is because this thing actually has a better processor on it, believe it or not. This is a 700 MHz CPU, as the Power Mac G4 over there has only a 600 MHz. Which, yes, I know it's bullcrap, but whatever. What you gonna do? Let's go ahead and get the thing out of its spot. Okay, this is my Power Mac, this is my Emac G4. This used to be a part of the special ed department. I pretty much made it a little tutorial of this machine. I like these old Power Macs a lot. I mean, like, the G4s are just intriguing because at one time, these were the most powerful machines ever to exist. And obviously, nowadays, it's not. It's, like, crap. I mean, like, this thing's trash. But there was a day that PowerPC was probably the most powerful, robust option you could possibly get. And believe it or not, even when PowerPC, even when Apple wasn't supporting PowerPC, and keep in mind, Apple is what kept the PowerPC line alive, but consoles even used PowerPC for a long period of time. The Xbox 360 and PS4, or PS3, had IBM PowerPC tri-cores in them, and it had a PowerPC-based graphics card. So, yeah, I thought that was kind of interesting. And that is a whole other rant I have to offer on how IBM was supposedly not willing to do... What's a fancy little Emac without a fancy Apple Pro, like Apple Pro keyboard thing? I just took an older black Pro keyboard and I put some of the black keys on the white version. This is greatly yellowed, though. Oh, I just dropped it. I don't have the original mouse in this system. I don't even think this keyboard's original for the most part. One thing I like about these Emacs is they really thought things out. I guess they thought that maybe, since these are education-based systems, I guess they thought maybe they'd need more USB ports for maybe, like, the special ed department might need, like, a switch or something. Like, one of those little buttons so that, like, kids in wheelchairs that can't, or, like, kids that have vocal problems, or kids that are in wheelchairs that have MS that can't, you know, they can't physically touch the, or can't physically talk, they can touch the buttons, and that way they can do stuff. I'll just use a generic Dell mouse and the infrared on. What is up with this thing's focus, honestly? This camera's never had a problem with focus. It's only recently that it's been acting this way. Well, that should be good, right? Alright, so I don't know how well the battery's going to hold out for this video, but probably going to have to edit the crap out of this video using Premiere. That's right, guys. I stopped using Pinnacle Studio, mainly for the fact that it was a piece of turd that was completely unstable. Can't stand Corolla Pinnacle anymore. I used to love them, but they had some pretty awesome design transitions and stuff, but once they started having all these, like, outrageous, like, bugs that would crash in an instant, but it just pissed me off so much. Although I will admit one thing, Corel and Pinnacle are awesome for the factor that they save your work in real time. Literally, it saves your work in real time, so if something crashes, everything's exactly the way it was, which is a huge thumbs up. Alright, now I gotta get a standard power connector, because I can get one. I might just leave that machine permanently set up there, actually. So I might actually use it for web browsing. Now, from what I heard, the reason why I didn't want to do this in the previous years that I've had this machine and my Power Mac G4 and Power Mac G5 was mainly to the factor that I thought it would be stupid. And the reason why I thought it'd be stupid is I thought that I heard that these supported Linux versions are supported still, and they are indeed used still, but unfortunately I heard a lot of rumors that, oh crap, I have a cable got tangled. I heard a lot of rumors coming from people that there was very little software available for these platforms. And if you did do it, well, you know, stuff would happen. One of the main reasons I didn't want to do this was practically because my Emac here has a bunch of vintage Macintosh games that I hold dear to my heart. And I simply just didn't want to lose them all. But at this point, I can honestly just give a damn. I don't really give a damn. So I'm just going to go ahead and put this in. Now, before I go into any more details about this Power Mac, I will say, or this Emac, I will say that this machine consisted originally of, spec list is in here, hold on. Alright, I don't know if you can see it there, but there is the G4 700 MHz, 128 MB of RAM, 4D, I don't know what that means, CD-ROM, USB, and as you can see, 110 volts. Now, this machine no longer has a CD-ROM, it has a DVD-ROM, that was a RAM, my bad, it was upgraded. This machine now has a full gig of RAM, so that's also been upgraded. But the Power PC G4 is still in there, and it's still kicking. And I figured I'd screw around with this machine before I see burn a disc. Now, I'm a little low on DVDs, I will admit that. So I'm not going to burn a DVD. I'm actually going to be burning Kubuntu 12, and I know that's a little out of date, mainly for the factor that Ubuntu is a long-term supported system, and those versions are still supported, but Ubuntu is kind of the people that it's highly recommended that you do update when you can, just for pure security reasons, but it's kind of like Mac OS, you know, update while you can, because like I said, it'll be unsupported pretty soon. But just to get one last look at this system, let's go ahead and fire her up. If I could just find the goddamn power button. Oh, there we go. Oh, no chime. Yes, I had the speakers muted or something. This machine, I go back with these machines. I remember we had these in all our classrooms. Of course, what kid in the, born in 1999, didn't see all of these in their classrooms. These things were very common. Seeing these in classrooms were very common. Now, at one point, as you can clearly see, the built-in memory test has detected a problem. Please contact a technician for service. Okay, I guess my RAM is corrupted or something. That might be an issue I have to look into. Or maybe the RAM's not in the slots all the way. Anyhow, these machines were pretty cool, actually. Honestly, they really were. But I remember we had this, as you can see, there is a burn-in on the screen that says, "Welcome to Mac OS, welcome to the Wyndham Public Schools Macintosh Network 1. As you can see, believe it or not, my school system back, this dates back until 2011, or 2012, they finally got rid of it. But there was a Macintosh network for every single iMac G3, and iMac G4, and Emac G4 in the network, and even the older stuff. We're talking like stuff like a Performa series machines, I believe, really like sluggish 100, like maybe 200 megahertz Power PC G3s. So we're talking very old there. And those machines, believe it or not, ran on the same OS version 9. I think all of the machines were on 9. Somehow they gave those, the Performa machines, to the teachers in an effort to, because they had capture software on them, so basically they could display the video to the TVs on the, in every classroom. They had a TV in every classroom, so I guess that was like an idea they had. But I digress. Essentially the heart of the story was they had Mac OS 9 and Mac OS 9 servers for these machines up until 2012, and then even when they ended the support, they still had the file server running. So I don't know what they did, but they had that server running continuously. And there was no reason why they had it running, but they had it running continuously until 2015. They just made it so you couldn't write data to the server anymore. And your account settings would not be changed anymore. Accordingly, you can log in with that account, but that's just about it. Which means the server is still there. It would give you a huge BS saying, "Oh, cannot find the authentication servers." And it would take like 15 minutes to hit off or run in some mode. I don't remember what it was, but anyhow, that's part of the video. Like I said, I got this machine from my school system. It was in the special ed department, and the technician, I know the technician there, but he told him, "Once this machine dies, I'm no longer going to be fixing it for you guys." Oh God, it's gonna start screaming here. He said, "Once this machine dies," what the freak? "I'm no longer going to be supporting it for you, so when it dies, it's hitting the curb." So I talked to the guy about taking it, and he said, "Yeah, sure." And it turns out the RAM was just dusty in the machine. Cleaned out the RAM, she roared back to life. So that's just a little backstory between this stuff here. As you can see, we are running Mac OS 9. And QuickTime has some issues here. Oh, shut up. There's some corruption issues on this machine. Oh, god damn it. I don't know. Like, this machine was used in the special ed department, so... Yeah, I forgot. There's no... I'm thinking of doing something on, like... What's even in this? Can we empty this? Yes. Why does it even matter? I'm just gonna format the whole disk. I really like Mac OS 9. I'm not lying with you guys. I think Mac OS 9 is an awesome operating system. And
the application, add this to stuff.
I don't want to hear it. Yeah, so this is the last view we're going to get of the machine like this. So we're going to go ahead and hit shut down. And the machine should power off for its last and final goodbye of Mac OS 9. So, like I said, I'm running a little low on CDs or DVDs here, so. But needless to say, I got plenty of CDs. some of those are DVDs, but I'm trying to conserve the DVDs for actual computer builds and stuff. Some of these are actually being used. I'm not even sure of all of them. But I'll see if I can find a blank one. Maybe if I find a blank one, I could probably throw actual Ubuntu 14 on it. Or you know what? Screw it. I'll just put Kubuntu. I don't want to burn a whole goddamn new disk just for something I'm only going to use once in a lifetime, you know? So, we'll just go ahead and throw Kubuntu on there. Okay, I don't know why my file server's pulled up. Let's exit out of there. Oh, I got running in the background here. Oh, crap. This is my main video editing machine, so essentially downloading stuff from here might not be the best idea. I'll be right back with the file. Alright, so what we're looking at here, as you can see, we got some options here. We've got Mac, right, AMD 64. Oh, here we go, Power PC. But this is for 64-bit Power... No, maybe it's not. Hold on. Mac.template. I'm assuming this is Power Architecture 5. Give me a second. I think this is, in theory, for Apple machines right here. I'm assuming. I'm not exactly sure. We'll try this. This looks assuring. Actually, I don't think I could install it from there. Maybe it's in here. Let me see. Install live. There we go. That's 64, but here we go. Okay, right here. This is what we need. And that looks like it would fit snugly on a CD. Just like a snug and a bug in a rug. So let's go ahead and download that. And yeah, I'm going to have to switch my internet from this over to the main fast switch. I have a massive old, like, 10 megabit hub. It's such a piece of crap. But it works, nonetheless. But it's a piece of crap. So why don't we turn the light on in here, because I can't see crap. Let's get this out of here. We'll plug this into the hub, because this is for the living room computer. And, which one of these is for the, it's either 20 or 18. Which looks better? Yeah, I think it's 20, actually. Is it 20? Right, I guess it's 20, so we'll plug 20 into here. Whoops. Here we go. Now I'm gonna have to re-download that file, because it's most likely, like, throwing a fit, saying, oh, you've, done something this, and it's probably stopped the download. That or it's going light speed. Holy Christ. Okay. See, that's how fast it goes when it's not plugged into the hub. Struggles of life, but I will admit one thing. That hub was free, so I am not criticizing. It was free, and that's all that matters. And this is going to be a long video. So if anyone that's actually watching this, God bless your soul. This has got to be cancer for you. Did I insert that disc in this machine? Where's that disc? I put it down somewhere. I think I put it down. Maybe I put it in the bottom DVD drive. That's in the bottom. Ooh, it opens slowly. That's kind of cool. Because apparently it's in the bottom one, so. Let's see here. Well, these drives better be able to read crap. I will be so upset this thing can't read them. Huh. It's an audio CD. How awesome. So this thing already has a volume on it. That's kind of disappointing. Oh, I think I burned this one, actually. I think this has my music on it. Huh. What the hell would I burn music for? I listen to my stuff on, like, 8-tracks and stuff. I don't know why I'd burn myself a CD. CDs are, like, the last place I'd listen to music, to be honest with you. I can't stand CD audio. It's all distorted and crap. Like, that's how I listen to music, guys, if you're wondering. I can't not stand stuff like that. So maybe this one's blank. I have no idea. These CDs aren't labeled, so maybe they're blank, maybe they're not. Who the frick knows? Alright, looks like this one could be burned, too. So, why don't we burn this to here? That or the disc isn't valid. Ugh. The struggle. The struggle here is real. That's a blank DVD. I need to save that. Okay. CDR. Should be good, right? Should be good. I think this one's pretty much blank. I'm not sure. But I could be sure. I'm not sure. So, let's just find out. Let's see if this one's... Yep. Please wait. Setup is getting burner ready. Oh, come on, man. That had to be... Maybe it's just the... Maybe it's just this drive. Maybe this drive's not compatible with burning discs. Let's see what this one is. It says DVD-ROM. I assume it's a burnable drive. This one says RW. I don't know. Oh. This apparently has something on it. Apparently have sacks and wheels of steel on it. What the hell? Okay. Heavy metal 80s rock. God knows why the hell I burned that. But I guess I found my mixtape. Alright, well let's look through something that isn't cancer here. Yeah, these are probably burned too. The rest of them are all good, so oh my god, I'm so lucky those landed face down. Let's look through these here. These are either all DVD-Rs or CD... Oh my god, they're all DVD-Rs. Okay. Well, I thought I didn't have DVD-Rs, but it's very clear I have a fat stack of them, so... screw it, burning this to a DVD-R. I didn't think I had that, but maybe I do. I have to close that again. Well, apparently had stuff on it. What does this have on it? No way! I gotta show this to someone. I knew who producted this play, and I know exactly what play this is. This is at the high school. Oh my god, I need to save this disc. I just found a treasure of the high school here. I know exactly who this belongs to, and I know who to give it to. So I'm going to save this DVD. But I guess all these DVDs have crap burned to them, which is kind of depressing because I really did want to burn some stuff onto these, and I guess I don't have any burnable discs. I have to have burnable discs. There's no way in hell I don't. I know these are burnable. I wanted to save these, but... Well, looks like we're going to have to burn these instead. Actually, I don't think I can use that one. I think I can use this one. Yeah, this is the only burnable drive, so I'm going to have to use this one. This should indeed be, this disc should be blank. If this is not blank, I'm going to be so annoyed. Alright, this is blank. Good. Let's get this body started. See how fast this thing can burn. I'm really hoping it's going to burn at an 8x speed. And just a little tip for all you guys out there that are just starting out in the computer enthusiast community, or at least doing stuff when it comes to burning discs and stuff. For anyone that's interested in burning a disc of that would be readable by a computer, always burn an 8x. Of course, you could burn faster, and you could achieve a faster burn speed, but that would also mean that you're going to reduce the life of the disc. Assuring if the disc gets any tiny scratch, it's not going to read it right. Another thing that'll be really hard is older optical drives will have a very hard time reading the disc, and most optical drives in general, except for very high-end fancy ones. So it's very, very good that you burn an 8x. Now, the thing about Windows Disk Image Burner is that it'll burn an 8x no matter what, so that's definitely a very handy feature that you always want. Being this is a very small file, it's not going to burn much. Now, I should have done a bigger version, to be honest with you. I'm kind of upset that I did this in 12. Because I think maybe 14 would have been more acceptable. But being this is an older machine, I guess 12 will have to do. I've heard a lot of good things about this, so I've never tried it for myself, although I'm going to try it. I've really never tried Kubuntu. I've tried Lubuntu, Kubuntu, Ubuntu itself, Kali Linux, Puppy Linux. every kind of Linux known to man besides, I even use Mint, besides Kubuntu. So this is going to be kind of an interesting theory here. And that disk image was successfully burned. Now, I'm very happy that I did install, I believe that, very happy I did install this to here. So, let me go ahead and hit, I don't know if these Power Macs, pretty sure if you hold this, it'll pop out. Maybe not, maybe I just have to hold the eject button. Now, if it's got an eject button, you might as well push it. I guess that feature doesn't work anymore. I'm just going to hard shut down the system. Maybe not. Maybe it'll read off the disk. Moment of truth, guys. Oh, it didn't want to do crap. Okay, I'm pretty sure... Let's go ahead and shut this down. Or just hard shut it down. It doesn't really matter. Due to the pure theory that we're not going to be doing this. So why don't we go ahead and power this guy back up. Hold C. I believe it's C to boot off of a CD or DVD or something. I believe it's C. I'm not entirely sure. Could be completely mistaken here. I hear the drive doing stuff. Oh. This is a new screen. Oh. We've got a cursor. Oh, hell yeah, buddy. We got Kubuntu. So I've never tried doing this. I believe we got to do live like most older versions would. Loading kernel. Unable to open file. Invalid device boot. Oh, hold on. It's doing it on its own. Okay. Let's wait. Loading kernel. Okay, I got a little scared there. Let's gotta load the camera off the CD. Now these machines did not have very high bandwidth ATA devices. Keep in mind these machines did not have serial ATA. Something that Apple did terribly wrong with these machines was A, when they did start using SATAs and the G5s, they did not, and I don't know why the hell they didn't do this, but in the later revisions of the G5s, they never added in any form of freaking. They never added in any form of freaking, SATA 2. They always use SATA 1. And they use SATA, or ATA, not SATA, just regular plain old PATA, ATA in general. And all the machines up until, I believe, the G5s, really. So, I don't know what the hell they were thinking, but clearly, around the later revision of the G4s, there was a serial ATA. I believe there was even serial ATA in 1998, although it was very, very uncommon, and it was very, very expensive, but they could have done it, and they just chose not to, so, yeah, I think there was ATA in 1998. If you're in the video comments section, just let me know, or serial ATA, my bad. So, hold on, when in doubt, just type, enter, just press enter. Okay, there we go. Alright, now it's gonna do something. Wow, that DVD drive does not sound happy. Alright, the kernel's loaded, so now it's gonna load the RAM disk here. Okay. This is the first time I'm ever running Linux off this machine, and quite frankly, it'll be the only time I'm gonna do it because this will probably be a permanent installation. Holy Christ! That drive sounds like it's gonna die. Jesus. Oh God. Green's blank. We got a cursor. Okay. Okay, we're running without the GUI probably because mainly of the fact that GUI was not working. So we're going to run United States. Let's go through this here. I'm quite surprised this is actually working. The last time I did try Linux on this machine a while ago, and it was terrible. I mean, like, it was pretty bad. Oh, okay, we're doing this. So we're going to want to press Q, Z, no, 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 no. No. Just rest. Okay. I always really like that keyboard layout detection thing. Detecting harbor to find CD drives. This is pretty basic stuff. This is going to be really nice. I'm not even lying with you guys. I've always actually wanted to use this machine with Linux on it. I'm hoping with Linux, this machine will actually be more usable than it was before, because when Apple stopped supporting these machines, a lot of applications and a lot of other stuff was no longer being supported. And that was something Apple could have done a lot better, was the transition from PowerPC over to Intel, and they really didn't. They stopped supporting Mac OS, like maybe, for PowerPC, I believe, maybe 2 years after they switched. Or no, it wasn't that long, but they could have done some sort of transition like Microsoft Windows did, or Microsoft with Windows XP, you know, they gave everybody security software for free and whatnot if you were going to still use Windows XP, and I respect that. That was a smart decision on their behalf, but Apple, on the other hand, didn't give two dams. As long as they're getting more money in their pocket to switch over to Intel machines, it was okay by them. I'm not necessarily saying that their thing was justified. I'm not saying that it's unjustified, because for those who do not know, like, the whole transition of Apple coming over to Intel was a good move. I mean, like, one of the things was you can dual boot between all the operating systems, not just your Linux, like you're seeing right here, but you could actually boot your system, and also we're talking Windows and other machines that are compatible with that. We're talking all sorts of stuff here. But although, for those who are wondering, there were PowerPC Macs back in the day that had a Windows emulation card on it, and what it did is it actually had a Pentium 2 processor on a card, and the card snapped into your motherboard. And essentially, when you went to put in Windows, it would run off of that processor, but use all your hardware, but run off of that processor, which was something they developed in that time, but it was very expensive to do, and it was only really available to product developers, to be honest with you. Essentially, other than that, it was kind of a useless idea. Nowadays, you can just use Bootcamp to install all the drivers necessary on Windows, and you're done. And I gotta admit, you know, Microsoft really did a hell of a good, or not Microsoft, but Apple really did a hell of a good job doing that whole idea. But there's one thing I really can't stand now about Apple, is their whole idea of making everything super slim and cutting out performance in the process. It's just really freaking irritating. So host name, I don't know, I guess I'll call this machine TS200-34. Because I think this is like the 34th. I think that was the original host name. Full name for new user. I don't know. We'll go with Tyler. He's probably going to ask me for a password, username for your account. Well, empty password. He entered an empty password. Which is not allowed. Okay. Well, we'll just put in poop. I don't really care. To be honest with you. Here's use weak password. I don't give a damn. Encrypt, no, because that takes a hell of a long time to encrypt my home directory, and that's the last thing I want to do. Based on a physical location. Wow, so it actually is using the Ethernet right now. Jesus Christ. Detecting disks and all of their hardware. Yeah, I've always wanted to do this, like I've said. I never did it, though. It's one of the things that I actually did regret with these systems, is, this should have been a Geek Power episode, to be honest with you, but I decided not to. I heard problems with these machines included the speakers not working correctly. Who knows? Maybe I'd throw Mac OS X 10.4 on here just for a hell of it. Guided use entire disk. Use entire disk. It sees it as a SCSI. The hell? Why does it see it as a SCSI? Computing the new partition. So we're deleting the whole disk. I mean, like, there's not going to be Mac OS 9 after this. No, I didn't mean to do that. God damn it. Yes, finish partition changes. Yes. All right, here we go. Bye-bye, Mac OS 9. See you later.
macOS 9 is gone. We're not going to see that guy for a while. Installing the base system. This is going to take a while, so I'll go ahead and shut the video off for now. This whole video is going to be a pain in the ass to edit, and it's also going to be really stupid to watch. I bet you guys are going to be very, very, very annoyed watching this, so here we go. I'm going to pause the video here. Oh my god. Alright, seriously, that was kind of excessive, but we're currently at 98%. I'm installing base system, and it would appear... Oh, great. That's such a fucking mind tease. You gotta love that, don't you? Well, it's not gonna take that long. Running CD set, please wait. Oh, yeah, I remember this too well. Oops, I didn't mean to do that. Okay. Didn't mean to hit escape, I meant to hit tab. Yeah, there's like one key up here, but I don't know. It's just the keyboard I'm used to. Tab is like right next to it, and this key's a little bit shorter on my Lenovo ThinkPad, so that's a little different for me. Scanning the mirror. I don't think I'm going to install updates on this system. I do think Firefox is indeed supported for this. I am not sure, so we'll just have to find out. Well, I'm just gonna pause the video here. I'll let you know when it's done. Holy Christ. So, I've been sitting here waiting for this system. Hold on. System clocks generate coordinates. The operating system uses in your time zone. Convert the system to local time. This is recommended. I have been waiting for this system to install this forever. I mean, I've been really waiting for this system to install, and it has gotten really nowhere until now. So I would say this install literally took 2 hours. I am never doing this again. I at least want to be able to hear my chime. Oh, did Linux kill the boot chime? No! That's gonna make me so sad. That honestly makes me really sad. If it killed the freaking startup chime. Well. Ooh. Holy crap, the camera doesn't like that. Oh, Jesus Christ. Well, that'll give someone a seizure up the butt. Alright. Well, it appears that the system is indeed booting. I'm kind of sad it killed the classic Mac chime. I got a message on Messenger. Wow, that's really sad. I'll be right back, though. I'm gonna check that message. So I just noticed something about the system. I think she locked up. She went into booting, and then she just locked up. So I'm really hoping that install isn't corrupt. And if the install isn't, then I do remember the Mac OS 9 saying that the memory was corrupt. Or something was wrong with the memory, the RAM. So, I could try swapping out some RAM, see if that solves it, but this is the largest capacity RAM I have at the moment for this system. I probably would have to take some RAM out of the PowerMac G4, which I really don't want to do. But, we might have to really consider something here, because it appears that the system did lock up. And she's not responding to eject, she's not responding to anything, she's just locked. So essentially, I might have to, if I can find that power button here. The power button? Yeah, it's the power button. Oh yeah, she locked up. So we're gonna have to try booting the system again. We'll see where it gets us. I'm kind of sad. It killed the Mac OS chime. That's kind of depressing. I kind of was happy to see that. Ubuntu Bootstrap. Okay, so it's gotta work. If this doesn't work, then I might just say screw it, and I might just install Lubuntu on this machine. 16, or maybe not 16, because I despise the newer versions. Yeah, so it's going here. If I remember correctly, it should have a gear right here. I've seen that a lot of these versions have like a gear right here, so I don't know why I'm not seeing that here. Man, is that CRT of a nasty burn-in. Look at that. That is one nasty burn-in on the CRT. And there's actually a burn-in in the taskbar at the top. I never realized that. Look. There's a burn-in up there. Damn. How much do they use this thing, honestly? That must have been recent, because actually it's not that recent. You can see the login screen is definitely burned in there. WHS. This one was definitely used a lot. It's just, starting mouse emulation. This is, we got further here than we did last time. Oh. Ooh. Okay, we are getting somewhere. It's taken a long, I mean long time, but we are getting somewhere. Ooh. Oh. Man, I think this hard drive might just be total crap. Oh, would you look at that? We actually got a login screen here. Okay, so our username is TYLER, and our password should be poop. And in theory, yeah, would you look at that? We got, whoa, look at that cursor. That is one sick-ass cursor. And that should be like the loading screen. If I remember this operating system correctly, that is the loading screen. This system is really slugging, and quite frankly, I don't blame it, because this is a very old machine, and it's definitely not up there in the ranks of running this operating system, so it's kind of a miracle that we got this far in this OS. Mainly to the sheer factor that this hard drive or this storage controller is not up to what you might think. And a lot of people might be wondering, whoa, hold on a second. And believe it or not, the Power Mac or the Power Mac G3s and the iMac G3s actually had faster I/O than the actual Emac G4s and Power Mac G4s and the iMac G4s. It was really pathetic. USB was faster on the G3s. FireWire was faster on the G3s, and overall disk transfer rates were faster on the G3s, which is complete fucking bullshit. I don't know what Apple did to possibly think of such a stupid thing to do on its next generation machine, but clearly they weren't in their heads, and they did something really dumb, and, well, let's just say they shouldn't have done it, okay? So we're talking about a very slow hard drive performance here, and I'm not blaming the machine for this performance. You gotta keep in mind we're running off of an old hard drive. Maybe I might upgrade the hard drive in the future. I have taken this machine apart to get the DVD drive in this thing, and let me say it was not easy. I do not want to do it again. My friend Technology's Edge, you might know him on YouTube, he actually does have a very nice, handy, next-generation Emac that has a 900 megahertz Power PC G4. But his machine is actually much, and I mean much more, it's much more up-to-date. It came with a DVD drive, I'm pretty sure. And he actually installed Leopard on it. There's actually a way that you can trick Leopard into installing it on a less than 1 gigahertz G4, so there is a way to do it. It's not recommended. It would appear that we're running. Really slow, but we're running. I bet once the hard drive like dies down a bit, we'll be running a little bit better here in terms of performance. It would appear that this system is definitely, I mean like definitely slugging. Power Emac Snapper Audio Stereo. Oh, looks like our audio driver's not there. Whew! This thing is screaming. This thing is screaming slow. The graphics controller is definitely not the best thing out there, but in theory, we should definitely be able to get onto an up-to-date version of Google on a machine that was released in 1998. So I guess that's an improvement. Essentially, I'm not sure. I do have a couple of clients that still use Power Emac G5s, and I have used Ubuntu for them to keep their machines up to date. Somehow, machine seems to be more responsive all of a sudden. I have gotten this machine on the Internet Explorer with Mac OS 9. Well, there's a semi-up-to-date version of Google there. A little bit out of there in terms of updates. This machine is definitely running sluggish, and I could see why, being that this system is running off of a 900 megahertz G4. I wonder if there's a utilization manager here. It would appear that the system is becoming a lot more responsive as we go, and like I said, that's probably caused with the poor hard drive transfer rate, like I assumed. Let's see, computer. Let's see what we got in here. Let's see what we got in system here. Additional. I'm gonna have to update some drivers in here because there's clearly not an updated driver for the. Or maybe there is an updated driver for the audio. It appears that there isn't. Oh. I guess maybe there is. I guess we do have audio in the system, huh? Oh, system monitor. Let's see. Okay. No, that is pretty cool. That I give a lot of props to. This system is slugging. It's slugging, but she's running. Needless to say... Oh, fuck the hard drive. I think we need a whole goddamn new CPU. Well, you gotta keep in mind we are running off of a 700 megahertz Power PC G4, and that is definitely true, because that fucking utilization is absolutely crazy. We're talking 100% here. Unless the system does not have any supported threads to allow it to stay idle, then maybe there isn't. Is there an idle CPU? No, there's not an idle task. I don't think that's actually at 100%. I think that means it can limit to 100%, but I don't think that's actually 100%. We're kicking around. We're really up there. I mean, like, we're really up there in terms of usage. This is like a... Okay, so I laughed because I thought this system was staying at 100%, but actually, clearly it's not. This system, believe it or not, cannot physically stay at... Oh my god, that freaking... Okay, let me back this camera up a second. This system cannot physically stay at 0%. Now, for most operating systems... And for those who do not know, a CPU is always considerably loaded. It may not seem that way, but it's always loaded. And a lot of the times it is loaded, every time it is loaded, it's especially with Microsoft Windows and with other operating systems, there's a background task keeping it loaded, but at very low minimum CPU usage. And that is called system idle task. If you ever go into Task Manager, go to Processes, and go into... a process in there, you'll notice that there's a function called idle or whatever, and that leaves a CPU unloaded, so other tasks can reserve themselves to it. I guess this operating system does not have that function, making that CPU thing stay at 100, or maybe it's just there to mark that this is a single core system. Maybe with every core, the system gains like another 100. Like, if this is a dual processor system, that'd be 200% CPU. Obviously, being that this is not a dual processor system, there is one thing I will say about the system, and that it uses an AMD Rage card. So we're looking at a very low-end card for something that would, in theory, be a lot better. But we're looking at decent performance here from what this machine's age is to be expected. We're looking at some pretty good things here. I mean, like, it's not Blue Devil. Huh. And we do have Mozilla Firefox. Wow. Browser install. Okay, that's the installer. I will omit one thing. This operating system is awesome for having. I might actually install this as my main Linux distribution. This is looking pretty promising. Although, if this machine actually does run up to what I think it's going to run up to, because as you saw, I did get up to a pretty up-to-date version of Firefox, which... Oh, password poop. Which is good, because I actually do want to use this system for web browsing down here in the basement. That's why I have it set up here. I might actually leave it permanently set up next to these machines for more, like, Linux-based applications, but I can mainly do web browsing on it. That's all I really wanted out of this machine when I got it. I was originally planning to go to Mac OS X Tiger in an effort that maybe that was the minimum support I was going to get out of the system, mainly towards the fact that A, there's not a lot of PowerPC applications out there, and B, I didn't think these Linux distributions were updated so frequently. Clearly, I was proven wrong, and this Linux distribution is far updated enough to really run these custom distributions. As you can saw, I am in a version of Google that is still supported somehow. YouTube, I bet, is going to be complete cancer trying to play. And like I said, that's mainly due to the graphics processor not being powerful enough. And you can't blame the system there. And these systems do not have interchangeable graphics cards. So I believe this is a Rage. These G4s used Rage cards. I don't know why Apple decided to use those cards, but it was very common for them, and that's what made them sleep happily, so... Nonetheless, it's running a little sluggish, but... I keep on saying that, but, you know... You know, we gotta keep in mind, this machine was from 98, and was this machine in 98 or 99? I think this machine was in 99, so... We're talking an operating system that's as old as me, and that's... Or a machine that's as old as me, and that's 17 years old. And this machine is actually on an updated version of YouTube. So you have to give it props that this is somewhat impressive for a 17-year-old computer to possibly still being supported. It's just nice. I highly doubt that actually playing a video would be anything like it. I'll play one of my videos. STEFFEN200. Enter. That's my YouTube channel. Obviously the hard drive in this thing is maxing the crap out. You can definitely feel it maxing out here. And with the installing packages, it doesn't look like this system's gonna get much of a break anyhow. Like I said, guys, I do not expect this system to do a whole hell of a lot. It is a very old system. Obviously, right now, the network use is limited because right now this thing's got a very bad, it's got very bad transfer rate stuff in it. We're talking old hardware here. And look at that super smooth scroll, guys. Now, this actually is similar to the performance that you would experience in Tiger in one of these systems. I mean, like, OS X Tiger would do something very similar with these machines. Especially with the low-end one like this. These machines never really ran that well in the field. They were only really meant for education use. They were never really meant for something super, super, super powered. And clearly, you can see that here. I still can't get over the fact that it killed my startup chime. That's kind of bumming. I really wish it had the startup chime still. Or maybe it will do it. I don't know. Maybe it'll surprise me. Now that I actually got the volume unmuted, maybe it'll actually do it. Installation complete. Thank you. I'll use Firefox later. Oh, jeez. This is one hell of a machine to use. Let's view this video. It's going to be so cancerous. It's going to give me cancer, guys. God, I can't believe I actually did this. This is kind of fun. I never thought I'd get Linux on one of these old systems, honestly. I guess it's a fun thought. God knows if I'm ever actually going to use this system. I think it would have been better off with Mac OS 9. I think it would have been a lot more useful, but... It's web browsing. on a machine that's 17 years old. Obviously, I have some machines that are just as old as the system that would still be more supported due to the fact that they're actually a 32-bit architecture, but you have to keep in mind that even machines back then are very rarely supported, and if anything, this machine is a lot more supported than those were due to the fact that it's got a sheer power of a G4! And that G4s were definitely much more overpowered back then compared to any Intel Pentium piece of shit out there. Because these things were really competing with Pentium 3s, and these things smoked the Pentium 3s. They honestly really did. It appears that she's actually going to do this. I kid you not. She's actually going to play the video. Oh my god. It goes to the red blood. That's amusing. That's how you know your computer gives you cancer. Alright, well, we got Firefox now, so why don't we use Firefox? Oh, god damn it. What the hell? That's new. God damn. I honestly think it's the hard drive in the system that's really slugging it down. I bet you if I were to install a really nice ATA drive in the system, it would honestly really speed it up. I mean, like, this system would probably get sped up a lot faster than a normal machine, than a normal G4 would. That would probably be a project for another video, but for right now, I seriously do not want to do that. Doing something like that would just be cancerous because I know that it took almost 2 hours just to install that. So doing that again might not be a good option. But this is definitely a good operating system for such an old machine. I'm very impressed with this. I'm very, very impressed with this. I honestly might leave this machine here to be used from now on. Probably just going to edit through half of me talking about this because it's all going to be, oh my god, it's so beautiful, it's a Mac running Linux, and it's almost 17 years, it's almost like freaking 18 years old and it's running. I'm a freaking fanboy. Apple fanboys, if you're watching this is a finger to you. I have Linux running on a vintage Mac. If that's not a finger to the Apple fanboys, I don't know what is. Obviously, Firefox is running a lot smoother, and that is to be expected because Firefox, if you don't know what Firefox is originally designed for, it's designed to run on older hardware. That's why Firefox runs on computers gunked up with crap a lot better. And that's why I would prefer Firefox, because a lot of the machines I use are pretty old, and some of the ones that I do use, even for my higher-end machines that are pretty decently spec'd, they still use Firefox. I think it's awesome. I think it's really efficient. And I think it's honestly a very good web browser. A lot of people use Chrome, and they're entitled to use Chrome. I can't stand Chrome because of how much, like, raw usage it has in data-wise. I think, honestly, the amount of CPU and RAM that it uses is a complete cancer. And that's my opinion, but if you have higher hardware that can handle that, then go ahead. I'm the kind of person that I want to run as smooth as possible. I want absolutely no bottlenecks. And on hardware that I have, Firefox is the answer. So, why don't we go ahead. Wow, that is awesome. Why do I need to see that? We'll go to videos here. This is definitely going a lot faster, I will admit that. It's definitely running kind of slow, but it's nothing that we can't handle, right? Oh my god, the system can do multiple desktops. That is awesome. I might be actually getting a second Power Mac G5. I might actually do this with my Power Mac G5. Might be getting a second one, though, so that's something I want to look into. Crap, I shouldn't have full screened. That's too much graphics power. Oh my god. Okay, this GPU is not fit for it. This GPU is not fit to play YouTube. That is for sure. Oh my god. Oh my god, we're actually playing it. I got the image. Now, this is when your CPU lights on fire. I bet the fans in this thing are going to rev up pretty hard in a second here. This thing is obviously not liking this at all. Oh, I can hear audio.
Well, my hand hasn't been used in a while, and the time I did use it, it's
completely... Well, I got audio.
So, let's get on with the video. Today,
so I didn't break the sound driver.
Talking about my server room setup as of fall 2016.
Alright, I don't think this video could be any more stutterish than that, but yeah, it is playable. It is obviously cancer, but it's playable. Which is, I guess, something. I guess. There is no way to upgrade the graphics in these machines, at least not that I know of. So a graphics upgrade would be totally out of the question. But if this machine was upgradable, two of the things that I really need to upgrade in the system is A, graphics, and B, a hard drive. A hard drive upgrade would be greatly, willingly, like, amazing for this machine. And this machine would actually run like a normal computer. Because right now, I don't know if you can hear it, but I can hear that hard drive just cranking in there, just cranking and cranking. I might actually resize this disk and actually install Mac OS X alongside it. God damn it, the battery's gone. Man, this is going to be one hell of a long video. I might just split this into two parts. But yeah, I actually did it. This system is running Linux. I didn't think I could do it, but I did it. Something I've been wanting to do for a long time in this system. I'll restart it real quick. I'm going to go ahead and pause the video here in case if it dies. Alright, restart computer. I'm going to restart this machine. I'm going to see if it actually did kill the chime. Because I have the volume unmuted now, so if it did kill the chime, I am not going to be happy. Oh, it did a little logout sound. That's kind of cool. Apple did make the audio controllers for these systems, by the way. Apple at the time made a lot of their own hardware alongside with IBM at the time. So a lot of the hardware that you see in these systems, if you ever try loading Linux, a matter of fact, Linux developers have to go through hell just to find proper working drivers for these systems. So if you ever criticize these operating systems, don't, unless you're in someone else's shoes, especially the developers, because third-party operating systems for these systems are hell to make. I mean, come on. This is obviously slow and sluggish as hell, but for a machine that's 17 years old, this is pretty impressive that we can at least watch at least somewhat of a YouTube video on a machine of this age. Okay, what the hell? This machine has like the longest shutdown time I've ever seen. I think Mac OS... What the hell? What the fuck? Okay, It did. It killed the chime.